I desire a fresh anointing of the Holy Spirit. My God, I desire a fresh anointing of the Holy Spirit. I desire that anointing of the Holy Spirit. A fresh anointing. A fresh empowerment. A fresh ability. There is an anointing from God that when it comes on you, it changes your world. It changes everything about you. I'm telling you, folks, it transforms your life. It transforms you. It brings you to that place where God becomes a reality for you. It brings you to that place where the power of God, the wisdom of God, the ability of God becomes your standard of life. There is an anointing. It changes your worldview. It changes everything about you, everything about your experience in life. Ask God for that fresh anointing. You no longer become a Christian that just exists. You don't just become a believer that is hoping to get out of something. But rather, the anointing enables you to become that which God is, that which God stands for, that which God can bring about. The anointing of the Holy Ghost changes your world. It changes everything that concerns your life. The anointing of the Holy Ghost transforms you. You need that empowerment. It is the key ingredient of the offsprings of God. It's a superhuman ability. It's a supernatural grace. It affects your character. The whole man. The whole man. It says nothing like it can be found in all the treasures of the rich or the secret of the wise. It is not to be imitated. It comes alone from God, and it is freely given through Jesus Christ to every waiting soul. Let us seek it, for we may have it this very evening, this very moment. We may have it this very day, this very morning. Oh Lord, anoint us your servant. I want you to begin to cry to God for a fresh... See, the anointing of the Holy Ghost is not just speaking in tongues. It's not just we speaking in tongues. That's just, let me say, Many one-tenth of all the Holy Ghost is all about. Because I've seen folks that speak in tongues, but their heart is never changed. I've seen folks that pray in the Holy Ghost, but their spirit life, their physical life is not transformed. Their environment is still the same. Their beauty is covered in depression and oppression. That's not what God has for you. The anointing of the Holy Spirit changes your world. The anointing of the Holy Spirit transforms you. The anointing of the Holy Spirit. It is a divine enablement, people of God. It changes your entirety. It brings you to the place of favor. It brings all of God's glory, all of God's goodness for you. Oh, la bro toba, begin to pray, begin to pray. Nebro siki mama la bondoshi. La ba 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 sondoli brondo. It is the power of the Holy Ghost. Lord, I need your anointing. Lord, I need your anointing. Lord, I need that anointing. I need that anointing of the Holy Spirit that changes life, that transforms destiny. I need that anointing of the Holy Spirit. I need that anointing of the Holy Spirit that makes a difference in a man's life. I need that anointing of the Holy Spirit. I need that unction of the Holy Spirit that transforms destiny. I need that anointing of the Holy Spirit that moves man into a glorious place. And in that anointing of the Holy Spirit this morning, like never before, God, I need it. I need it, my Lord and my God. I need the anointing of the Holy Spirit. Talk to God this morning. It changes your world. It changes your world. It changes your affliction. God wants to do great things for you. God wants to do mighty things for you. God wants to do supernatural things that are way ahead of your imagination, way ahead of your dreams. That's what God wants to do in your life. That's what God wants to bring about.
Yes, Lord.
That's what God is interested in doing.
Hallelujah.
There's an anointing. There's an anointing.
Yes, Lord.
It separates your life from every other person. It separates your life from every other people on the face of the earth. You cannot walk under the anointing of the Holy Ghost and you are common. The Bible says the Levites were separated.
Yes, Lord.
They were not like every other person out there. The Levites were totally separated. They were separated by in every virtues, in every way. They were separated in everything.
Thank you, Father.
That's what God desires of us. The anointing distinguishes our conduct. Distinguishes our reality. Distinguishes the way we approach reality. There's something about the anointing of the Holy Ghost. It changes you totally.
Yes, Lord.
It changes you completely.
Hallelujah.
The anointing of the Holy Ghost has the power to improve your destiny. That's what the anointing of the Holy Ghost does. It's an anointing. It quickens a man.
Yes, Lord.
It lifts up a man from the place of regret.
Oh, God.
I tell you, folks, the anointing of the Holy Ghost is so beautiful that it will change your world. The anointing of the Holy Ghost is so unique that it will bring you to the place of supernatural favor.
Oh, yes, Lord.
That's what the anointing of the Holy Ghost can do for you. You don't want to live your life without that anointing.
Mm-hmm.
Folks, you don't want to live your life without that anointing. Mm-hmm. It is the anointing that brings changes in you.
Yes. Lord.
It is the anointing that brings changes in you.
Yes, Lord.
Le pro si kaman to re pro si ke mon to risha. Baka son to brikan do re bobo sita. La bobo si kalopo si kondopri. Kelobo si kalabatu. La balapro tori bababa sonte. Le pro si kamon to ni pro si kaman to ri babasu. Mele binda bundori bababa sonte. Oh, Holy Ghost, I need that anointing.
Holy
Ghost, I need that anointing.
Yes, Lord.
I need that anointing. I need to be quickened. Man sono prikondoli beshinda. Ye pamba son to bon de brinde. That anointing, that quickened.
Oh, Holy Spirit.
Spices for the anointing oil.
Yes, Lord.
Thank you, Jesus.
Thank you, Lord.
Thank you, Jesus. Go with me to the book of John, chapter 1. We're talking about the offsprings of God. This teaching is going to revolutionize the way you look at life and the way you look at yourself. You are not the first set of people or individual that God in His wisdom have set out to adopt. All right. Right, right. Want to hear me very well. You are not the first individual or person that God, in His wisest wisdom, have set out to adopt. God has always been interested in the adoption ministry or business. And I told you all from beginning, God has always been looking for a set of people to put in charge of the new world that is restored. God has always had the passion and a desire to bring new set of people into the realm of dominion. Well, He tried to adopt humans, and the human nature does not change. We as human beings, we've learned various ways of existing. We've learned various ways of improving our lifestyle. The animals haven't learned that. The bird still does what it has been doing since creation. The monkey still do the things they've been doing since creation. The ant still does what it has been doing since eternity, since creation. But for the man, we've evolved. We've discovered various ways of doing things. For instance, we now know how to make fire without getting burnt. Hello? I mean, there are all kinds of fire. There's some artificial fire. It brings heat, but it doesn't bring any smoke.
Mm-hmm.
Amen? We now know how to boil water, even without putting water in the fire. It boils itself. Amen? We know how to modernize the cars we use, computer technology, how to build homes that are more efficient. I mean, man can live in Alaska. Can you imagine that? Man can live in the North Pole, no matter how cold it is, no matter what it takes. Man adapts. Man causes the environment to adapt to itself.
That's right.
Man can live under the water with submarine. Amen? Mm-hmm. I mean, what Adam couldn't do, man can do all things. As far as the earth is concerned, man wants to go to another planet to see if they can live life there, if they can buy a ticket and go exist there. I mean, they are trying all kinds of stuff to do. Because man evolves. Well, God does not change as man does. God is not surprised because God gave man the wisdom. God gave man the ability. It gives God great pleasure for his children to succeed and excel in life. Now, here's the question now. When it comes to the things of God, God has not changed. The Bible does not change. The rules of God does not change. The counsel of God does not change. The purpose of God never changes. What God wants to do, that is what he's going to do. That is what God destines to do. That is what God will do. Its expectation of man has not changed. God has not changed. The laws of God has not been made irrelevant. The commandment of God does not respect a man, but you must adapt to the word of God. So God has always tried to adopt man and has failed. From Abraham, it went well. Got to Isaac, it went well. When he got to the town of Jacob, it didn't go well with God. Because the Bible says that Jacob had idols in his life. Jacob had idol worship. Rachel was worshiping an idol. Leah was worshiping an idol. In fact, in the house of Jacob and his children, they were idol worshippers. The concubines and everybody were idol worshippers. So you see, sometimes he's going to Bethel, he'll say, give me all your idols. He will go and bury them. Laban was pursuing Jacob to fight because his demonic idol was taken by Rachel. And that is the same Rachel that Jacob loved. So Jacob could not convince her to let go of an idol. Now you must understand that relationship, because some of us, God loves us so much, but yet God cannot convince us to let go of our idols. It seems that when idol grips a man's heart, it takes custody of that life. So God is in a dilemma. Now they go to Egypt. In Egypt, they copied more wicked ways, more wicked vice. In Egypt, they got contaminated. They got corrupted. Oh, here we go again. God is saying to himself, how am I going to solve this issue with these people? And God begins to figure out, what am I going to do? Well, he brings them out of Egypt and tells them, now, I'm the God, your Lord, that brought you out of Egypt. Don't have any idols. Don't do those trash. Don't serve no God. You shall not have any God beside me. Neither is anything created in heaven and earth. Now, what was God trying to do? God was trying to adopt them. God was trying to make them like himself. God was seeking. God, listen, God was seeking a means of acquiring the people for himself to make them his own property. God was seeking a means to adopt them, to make these ones his own, people that he can relate with, people that he can truly bless, people that he can truly transform their lives and cause them to become his sources in the face of the earth. God was trying to make these people his own people. He wanted them to become God's own property. Not the property of anybody, but adopted to become sons of God. And now, that is the issue. You know, that becomes a problem, you know. It's a real problem. God has to deal with that issue because it's a real problem. Getting people to quit what they're doing is a challenge for God. You go, what? Oh, yes. It's a challenge for God. I mean, can't you see your life? How long do you think you and God will be going back and forth with your life? How long do you think you and God will be struggling and contending, and you are always in God's face and God is always on your face, the word of God? In fact, there are so many of us that the word of God does not penetrate our heart anymore. We've gotten so hardened. You know what I'm saying? We've gotten so used to that word that we are not motivated by the word. The word of God does not have the ability to break through us, to cause us to be submissive to his will, to the anointing in our lives, to the anointing of the Holy Spirit. For some reason, we've got our mind made up that there are some of us that God will use greatly, and the rest of us will just float with God. When we get to heaven, we'll just tap him and say, thank you, Father. After all, that guy was helping to me. But what about you? There's an anointing on your life. God does not have a favorite child. God does not have He has only one firstborn, and the others are all the same right with him. But God failed, because God wasted his ability in destroying Egypt. So God said, the reason I'm bringing out of Egypt is for Egypt to know, for the world to know that there's a God. The only reason I made Pharaoh is to show my power, because Pharaoh is useless. I'm going to waste Egypt and waste that kingdom, waste that nation, just to demonstrate that I'm God. I know what you're going to do. You're rebellious and a stiff-necked people, but I just have to do it for my name, so there'll be a testament that I exist. So God wipes out Egypt, departed the Red Sea, took them to the desert. Now, taking them to a new environment totally from what they've been used to in the desert. Well, their father traveled through desert. Abraham traveled through it. Jacob traveled through it. So God says, let me take you through this. Now you are many. I want to prove to Abraham, because Abraham is watching me here. I want to prove to Abraham that, listen, I can do what I promised him to do. So let's go to the desert. And in the desert, God tried them. Why did he allow them to go to the desert? Why do you think you are going through your trials and temptation? Why do you think there's a reason for temptations? I know some of you have prayed, oh God, let every temptation cease. Let there be no more trials and temptation in my life. I don't want any suffering. I don't want, no, stop. You are going to go through it. If Jesus, the firstborn of God, went through it, you are going to go through it. It is the only school that your flesh understands. It is the only school that makes your flesh submissive to the will of God. That school of suffering and affliction. More so because you belong to God. You're of a different breed. You're of a different kind. Most folks don't talk about suffering anymore. The broadcast on the airwaves, they don't want to approach that issue of affliction. No. Jesus suffered for you. So move on with life. You are not supposed to say if you are suffering something. No. If you are suffering something, it's right. Everything is right. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
If you are going through challenges, everything is so perfectly right. If you don't go through challenges, you kill yourself. Folks that are so wealthy, they don't have challenges. Millionaires, billionaires, they commit suicide. What would make them commit suicide, for crying out loud? They don't have debt. They are rich in the world view. They can do what they want to do with money. They have power. And yet they are addicted to drug and alcohol. What is wrong? And they're having heart failure, liver problem. They drink so bad. What is the problem, brother? What's happening to you? Why are you doing that? Because there is a void, the nature of God in a man. God wants the man to be born by him.
That's right.
God has loved man so much that he gave his only begotten son. That's why if you refuse that son, there's only one thing left, condemnation and damnation. Mm-hmm. Life will be a misery and a shame and a defeat for such a soul.
Right.
It's a law.
Mm-hmm.
You have to accept his son. You have to be pleased with his son. You have to kiss his son. To kiss in the Eastern culture is to be bonded by love. It's to embrace, to welcome, to make one, to unite. And God requires that for you to become. The Bible says in Psalm 2, it says, kiss the Son, lest you get into problem. You embrace Jesus. Then you become like God. Now when you become like God, you have victory in life. What do I mean by victory in life? Jesus was God's son. Jesus was God. He was 100% man, 100% God. Yet, because he was under the world, he suffered all the sufferings and all the persecution that was designed for him to suffer. So, though you will be God on the earth, you still have to go through suffering. The church has to slap you. The high priest has to beat you up. Hello? But I keep on wondering, and I've said it so many times, even the night he was betrayed, the Bible says that Peter took a sword and cut somebody's ear, and Jesus took the ear and put it back. Paul, that was one of the brilliant, greatest miracles ever. apart from raising the dead. Man, this guy's ear is cut up on the floor, and there's blood coming out. And Jesus takes the ear back, touches the ear, and the ear gets healed instantly, and there's no more blood. And the same guy took his sword and said, come, let's go, let me go kill you. Thank you. But that's not the reason I'm here. You must die. It's a mystery. If it is me, boy, I'll say, no, I become a child of God. Right? What? The crowd careless of the miracle. They waited for him to do the miracle.
Okay.
It's okay, finish up. How you feeling, brother? You where now? Okay, we came for you. Let's go. Can you imagine that? Oh, pastor, I'm just good. I'm doing good stuff. I don't know why I'm going through life challenges. I'm a good person. I don't steal. I don't hate. Pastor, I give to the work of God. Pastor, I don't know why this is happening to me. Every time I do good, oh, I don't know. It seems hey, hush. Have you not read it? That in this world you get persecution. But pastor, I think because I'm a child of God, I'm a prayer warrior, a prayer captain, or a prayer professor, nothing should go wrong with me. I pray. No, hush. Hold on. Hold on. Wasn't Jesus flogged? Didn't they whip his back? His back was bleeding? Well, pastor, you know, no, tell me. Okay, what don't I know? You tell me. My place of work, they all hate me. I just tell God I'm tired of this work. I'm very tired every day. It's for the stressing me out. Whoa. Hold on. It's not because you've not lived the life under the anointing. Haven't you heard that my burden is light, my yoke is easy? Haven't you read Matthew 11:28? Come unto me, all ye that are heavy laden and burdened, and I will give you rest. So what is the issue? Well, you don't understand my problem. My problem is that no. You have not understood what God is telling you. That's God's problem with you. You have not discovered your true identity. You have not discovered that which God has equipped you to do with your life. You have not discovered whose property you are, whose father you have, where you are from. You've allowed the enemy to steal the word of God from you, that word that has the power to change your destiny. You have allowed the enemy to rob you of that word. You have allowed the enemy to take that word from you. You've allowed the enemy to reap that which was beneficial to you. So the children of Israel came to the wilderness. God did all kinds of miracles, gave them food. They were thirsty in the desert. There's no river there. Hundreds of thousands of people in the desert. No river, no stream. Just mountain. And God brought water from the rock. Boy, they drank water. You know, that water became a stream because for their animals to drink. I mean, they were not all crowded. No, the water ran to their tent in their front, carved a gorge so everybody could drink and draw. It's like a river. People can go deeper. And just a river was created. A canyon was carved out in the desert, flooded with water. They drank rivers. They kept on drinking. The water was there for them to drink whenever they needed. Took their bath. Boy, their animal drank water. Boy. Not one day, not two. It was just rushing.
Hallelujah.
It was just rushing.
Hallelujah.
It was just rushing. Boy, what kind of water is that? Didn't go dry. It didn't stop until they left that territory to places. That water was gushing and gushing and gushing and gushing. It meant it worked with them. It went with them. Amazing. 40 years later, they got to the promised land. After the first set of them died. Yet they have not gotten the hold of God. Right in the promised land, God begins to scatter them. Why? Because although God has adopted them, there were a condition of adoption. There was an agreement why they should remain in the blessing. You see, many folks can come into the blessing and still lose their blessing. They can come into the place of blessing and still lose the blessings of God. They can come into their place of providence and still don't know what to do. Not they still don't know. They still don't have a clue. They still don't have an idea what to do with their blessing. Oh my God. They still don't have a clue what to do with their blessing. They still don't have a clue how to do with their blessing. And they are laboring. They are laboring. Because they lack the anointing. John chapter 1. In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. The same was in the beginning with God. All things were made by Him, and without Him was not anything made that was made. In Him was life, and the life was the light of men. So you can't see if you don't have the life of Jesus in you. There's no way you can see your future. There's no way you can see your favor. There's no way you can become productive. There's no way that you can become a champion without the life of God in you. There's no way. There's no way. In Him was life, the life was the light of men, and the light shineth in darkness, and the darkness comprehended not. There's something about the anointing of the sonship of God in you. When you have been adopted, you have the light of God. That is the light of God. That's your legal tender right of adoption. When the light of God is in you, the light of God, there is no darkness. You hear me? There is no darkness, no matter what it is. There is no darkness that can conform you, that can comprehend, that can understand you, that can limit you. You see, when you understand a thing, you gain mastery over that thing. You have dominion over that thing. When you comprehend a math problem, it doesn't become a problem for you. Because comprehension means you know the logic behind it, the reasoning to it, the application of it, and what can be done with it. You become a master of that thing.
That's right.
If it's a machine you're driving or a tool you're using at work, when you comprehend that tool and what that tool can do and the bounds and the limitation of that instrument, you become the master. Now, it says the light shines in the darkness, yet the darkness cannot comprehend it. The darkness can never know all about God or what God's power and God's limitations are to dominate God. Darkness cannot comprehend it. So if the light of God is in you, it says this life is the light of men. It is given to mankind. When the light of Christ, the light of adoption, the light of being sons of sons and daughters of God manifest in you, you become an offspring of God. There is nowhere the powers of darkness can dominate you. I keep on saying it. I boast in the Lord, not in myself. There is no witch doctor. There is no voodoo priest that can compete or contend with me in this world. There's no witch. There's no wizard. As long as I remain in the light. Because it's your choice. If I choose not to remain in the light, it's my choice. You know what will happen to me? The least power in hell would destroy me. My flesh itself would destroy me. My own flesh would devour me first. But God forbid. I know too much now than to go back. How can you test? You've tested and see the Lord is good.
Mm-hmm.
And you want to go back. After you've tested and see. You've tested. And of this life. Of this power of adoption. Of this ability of as God's children. Of this uniqueness as a child of God. It's for me to go back. And going back. I read John chapter 1. It says, Let's read verse 12. John 1, 12. But as many as received him, to them he gave power to become the sons of God, even to them that believe on his name. He has given to become the sons of God. Now, let me say something about that. I want to share one or two words quickly about the sons of God. When we talk about the offspring of God, we're indirectly talking about the sons of God. There are so many advantages of being the sons of God. There's so many advantages of being God's sons, God's sons, God's sons, God's sons. What? Who are we? How do we behave? What is our nature? What is our conduct? What's the unique abilities we have? We have all of God's ability. Anything that God can do, I can do it. Oh, some of you go, what is he saying? See, I'm hitting your religious mindset. And now you are like, what? How dare he talk like that? Oh, well, that's the truth. There's no fake son of God in the viewpoint of God. There's no grade one son of God or grade two sons of God. We have access. We gain access to God. All of God's ability, all of God's power, all of God's goodness, all of God's providence, we have it. And now you're going to tell me, Pastor, okay, if you're a son of God, I need $1 million by tomorrow. No, make it happen. Well, we are not magicians. I didn't say we are magicians. I didn't get that. You know what I'm saying? I didn't say we are, oh, Pastor, I need to pay my bill. I just need $5,000. If you're a son of God, command you to come. No, 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 no. You don't turn stone to bread because you're a son of God. If you be the son of God, Satan told Jesus, my elder brother, says, if you are the son of God, turn stone to bread. Jesus says, no, 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 no. It is written. You don't live for money. We don't live by bread alone. You don't live for your own satisfaction, what you will gain, your benefit. But by every word. It means if God does not ask you to command it, don't command it. It means you are not independent of God. Son of God doesn't mean you are God of your own. Oh, I need a $1 million, so I take some white papers, lay bro, in the name of Jesus, become US dollars only. Well, that is voodoo. That is witchcraft. That's what occultic people do. Of course, they'll require human blood for that before they give you that. You know, the devil doesn't want, he can't afford to give you that. He needs human blood. He will tell you, go kill somebody and bring the blood and lock your fridge. Their money will be in your bag. You don't turn stone to bread.
That's right.
Oh, because I'm the son of God. Right now, I'll become Bruce Almighty. You know, have you watched the movie Bruce Almighty? My kids love that movie. The guy says, he says he wants to be God for one day. So, in the movie, he was given the power to be like God. You know what he did, first of all, was to mess up the whole traffic. He went and made all the cars on the freeway parked on the side, and his Lamborghini zoomed through. Then, the next thing, he made the dog to use the pee like a human being. You see that? Then he brought the moon. You know, everything was selfish. But when he did that, it was affecting the other climate. He didn't care. Then later he came to God and said, God, I don't want to be like you. It's too hard to be like you. The most funny part is the prayer request room. He opened a drawer, and the drawer pushed him for miles. The drawer said, what? He said, these are all your prayer requests you've been asking. May God give us wisdom into this.
Amen.
As sons of God, we have dominion over situation in life. What does that mean? It means everything that wants to suppress and subdue us, we subdue them. So does it mean you're going to get your resources? Yes. If you obey God's word, there are laws already for financial breakthroughs. It cannot change because of you. Tithing, sowing seed, that handles money. You don't pray to get money. You give to get money. It's a law. Oh, no. Pastor, agree with me. I'm just praying to God that I will have enough money for my new car note so that they don't take my car. Pastor, just agree with me in prayer. First of all, since you got that car, have you been faithful tithing? I just did last month. Well, then let the law work. Keep on doing it because it's a law. You can't just plant it today and be, no. You got to keep on sowing. Got to keep on tithing. Then God will begin to cause you to have creative abilities to make wealth. You don't pray for money. Now, I'm challenging. I'm rocking your imagination right now. You're like, whoa, what is he saying? You don't pray for money. You pray for abilities to get wealth. Father, I need the ability to get wealth. Well, what is the ability as a son of God? It means God gives you an idea. Money is, you are money. There's riches in you. You right here, you are money. You have money. Your life itself is gold. There is a gold mine in your heart. All the money you're looking for in life, you have it right now where you are. It's inside of your heart. You have to bring it out. The ability to make wealth is in you. You have to create it out from you. It is inside of you. There's certain things, ideas, creativity, talents, abilities that God has deposited in you right from your mother's womb. That is what will give you wealth. It could be intelligence. You're a very smart guy, so you have a good degree, and that degree gives you resources to give you wealth. It could be you don't even have a degree, but you can create things. You have business ideas up there. It's not because everybody is buying trolley head. You're going to buy trolley head. You can't do that. That is not your calling. You're going to lose money and you're going to suffer losses. You know what I'm saying? Mm-hmm. It's not because everybody is buying stockfish and putting it in a container and shipping it to Africa. It means you are going to, that's your business. That you're not getting that. Because that is not your business. You are not called out for that. Because everybody buy cars and ship to Africa doesn't mean you are going to be. So that is not your, that's not a business. That is somebody else's idea, that this person who started has already made fortune and you're just going to suffer losses. Oh, Pastor, I want to be a businessman, you know. I'm just believing God. No. You got to ask God, what abilities have you given to me to make wealth? Then God will open your imagination and show you the ability he has given to you to make wealth. There are all kinds of careers and fields in life. Those fields, there's someone that succeeds in those fields. God gives ability. As a son of God, prosperity and success is your portion. And as a son of God, poverty and suffering can also be your portion by your choice. I want you to pray with me this morning. Father, say after me. Heavenly Father, in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ, Spirit of the Living God, anoint my eyes, my spiritual eyes, to see my seat in your sonship, to see my position in your sonship, and know how to utilize the gifts
that
are already in me
for
your glory. In the name of the Lord Jesus Christ. Somebody begin to pray. I want you to talk to God.
Open my eyes, O God Almighty, Spirit of
that I might come
God,
out of every that bondage, that I might come out of every satanic bondage, every bondage of the corrupt world, the bondage of curses and limitation, in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ, that I might come into a full manifestation of your ability in me. As a son of God, there is a wealth in you. I'm going to start that teaching today for knowing your the privileges. If God owns the heavens and the earth, which he does, Don't you think as a son of God you have a right to some of the goodies in life? Huh? So Jesus became poor. So poor that at the day of his birth, I think he's the only one I've heard of that was born in a manger. That is the lowest form of birth available for mankind. Even those born at home, they are privileged. Those born in the farm. Did they tell you that your mother gave birth to you in the farm? Have you discovered that's why your life is hard? Oh, there are some folks, they born them in the farm. The mother was in the farm. I don't know what thing your mother was thinking in those days of great illiteracy. Hello? She's pregnant, she's still going to the farm. And on the road to the farm, give birth to you on the farm and you fell on the grass. And they carry you, wrap you, and bundle you. Tell you, see, that's how your life is hard. Everything about you is hard. Hard to the core. That's how you need to break it. You need to break that burden of oppression. You find yourself, you labor and labor and labor and labor and labor to your oppression. But Jesus was born in a manger. That's the most poverty-stricken place a child can be born. Yet, God went to prove a point that there was an exchange in sonship.
Hallelujah.
Kings with gold and silver and frankincense with resources, with their armies, traveled all the way. They went to the palace and thought he was going to be in the palace because, hey, if a king is born, he's got to be in the palace, right? So they went to Herod. Herod was like, whoa, all this gift for me? Boy, what? They said, no. We've come to see the king that has been born. He said, is that so? Where is there, say, the king? My wife is not pregnant. My wife, they have not given birth. How come you have her? He said, okay, you go look for this king. Because Herod did not believe it. Mm-hmm. Herod thought they were wasted people, that they were wasting their time. Or else he would have sent someone to follow them now. Mm-hmm. Because he said, no, don't mind those people. They just want to waste their time. And they saw this man. They brought gold, frankincense, and myrrh. Mm-hmm. They brought valuable perfume and everything. These are the compounds of anointing. They brought every resources and gave to him. Signifying that when you are a child of God, true riches come after you. You don't run after riches in the world. You don't run after wealth in the world. True lasting wealth, gold, will come to you.
That's right.
Because it is Christ's nature for the exchange. He became poor so that you and I will be rich. So the first anointing of the offspring of God is dominion over resources. Dominion over resources. Dominion over resources. You are going to begin to pray. Oh, Father, enlighten my understanding. Open my eyes, my spiritual eyes, my physical eyes,
yes,
to
Lord.
See the place of dominion, economic dominion,
yes,
and resources,
Lord.
Where you have given me to reign, whereby my needs will be met, whereby my resources will be discovered. In the name of the Lord Jesus Christ, wherever my abilities will be utilized, whereby riches will come into my life. In the name of the Lord Jesus Christ.
That every avenue will be utilized, oh God. Open my eyes, Lord God, that I will see, oh God, the dominion over the resources that you have brought to us in the name of Jesus Christ. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord.
Malabro do brekinda ba shonte boli bolobo sokinda baba kanda. Lebro sokiba baba shonto brigale baba shonte. Gebo bobo shondo libro gondo brigidi baba baba shonda. Bakalabra shonto brikalo brondo brikida baba baba shonte. Bagen dobre gondo brigan dobre kula baba baba shonte.
In the name of Jesus Christ.
Dominion of wealth. That's what God was trying to prove to them in Egypt. When God adopted them, the same thing happened. Just go ask for gold. Go ask for gold. Ask for gold. I want to prove to you that I take the earth as mine. And when I do things, I get what I want. And Egypt was, the Bible says, Egypt was plundered. They took all of Egypt's resources with them.
That's right.
And when they got to the, and guess what? When they got to the wilderness, the first thing the enemy tried to do was to take their gold. Aaron collected some of the gold to make a golden calf for them. You see, when you're on God's adoption process to become sons of God in Christ, the enemy will try to strike first to take the resources in you, the abilities in you. Hey, look at me. I was one time a musician, singing for the devil, producing music for the devil. I always laugh myself. What you call Lady Gaga's music. We did that. I did that 20-something years ago. If you doubt it, go to YouTube, type Amex, A-H-M-E-S, and look for Paparazzi. You see my video there. I was a young guy jumping out decades ago in Europe. You see the sound. You say, whoa, that sounds look like that. But was it not to give God glory? But that resources, the enemy wants to take it from you. Couldn't take the preaching because I've been preaching since I was a kid. But what am I trying to tell you? Your wealth is in you. The true riches you need is in you. Every ability that you're looking for as a child of God is in you. So you don't turn stones to bread. Rather, you create what God has allowed you to create. In Deuteronomy chapter 8, it says, I am the Lord your God that gives you the ability to make wealth. Deuteronomy 8:18. So as offsprings of God, we've been positioned to create wealth because God has abilities. God has abilities. There's no need for competition. There's no need for envy. There's no need for rivalry. There's no. There's great abilities in God. There are great abilities of wealth in you that has to manifest, that has to come out in the fullness of time. We've been adopted. We are the offsprings of God. Deuteronomy 14:2. It says, Deuteronomy chapter 14, verse 2. For thou art a holy people unto the Lord thy God. God requires holiness than any other thing. Riches or wealth is the easiest idol to corrupt a man. Oh, yes. Haven't you discovered it in your life? The minute all your bills are paid, you have so much money left over, you have too much money in the bank account, you don't even pray. You miss prayer line. You come in at the last minute. Haven't you discovered yourself? You don't even read your Bible. You struggle to read your Bible. In fact, reading the Bible becomes a pain. It's like a headache. Why should I pray, Pastor? Everything is, God is good. God is good. You know, you just wake up, hallelujah, hallelujah. You don't have time. God cannot even get your heart because your mind is racing. What am I going to do with this money? This business, this idea, this investment. Oh, your mind is racing too fast for you. You don't even have time for God. But wait, when there's no money, you're on that. Oh, before I even done the prayer, you're on the prayer line. If I'm even forgetting, you wake me up. Hey, get up. Got to pray. Hey, Pastor, what are you doing? Oh, Apostle, got to pray. Get up, pray. Why? Because you're in pain. Well, until that nature is broken, whereby God can trust you with true riches, yeah, you're on your own. If the little, the physical riches you have right now, God cannot trust you. You are afraid to give to the work of God. You are afraid to support the things of God. You are even afraid to use it. You go to Walmart, you are angry in Walmart. Why are you angry in the grocery store? Things are too expensive. Who told you they are too expensive? You're upset. Huh? Your spouse goes to the store and buys something. You are looking at the bag. Hey. You know what I mean? What do you buy there? It becomes quarrel. Oh, No. It means your heart. There's still idol in your heart. There's still idol in your heart. There are still things in your spirit, man, that is not like God's nature. If you are adopted to be like God, you take on the custom of the home that you are adopted into. You don't create your own custom in that home. When you are adopted into a family, you continue the family pattern, or else they will push you out right away. They will kick you out of that home. You must conform to that family you've been adopted into. It says, we have been adopted unto the Lord our God, a chosen people, a peculiar people unto himself, above all the nations that are upon the earth. Now, do you know why many people hate the Jews? Because they said you're thinking, because the Jews, the Israelites, they believe that word right there.
Oh, yeah.
That we are God's people. Mm-hmm. We are above. We are superior to every nation on the face of the earth.
That's right.
And it is true. Mm-hmm. Every scientist that have moved academic world and creativity is a Jew. Mm-hmm. You name them. 90-something% of all the scientists in the universe, they are Jewish origin. Your bankers are Jews. We love them because we are Jews as well. Because it's not the color, it's in the heart. It's in the spirit of adoption. It's the mind of God. You have, they understand the economies. They understand finance. They understand technology. They understand, they have a comprehension of life. When you have a comprehensive know-all of life, you will never be defeated.
Hallelujah.
You are going to pray with me. Father, quicken my understanding to know the full length of my adoption.
Mm-hmm.
The full length yes. Fullest of my abilities in Christ. I have an ability in God.
Yes,
I am not ordinary.
Hey,
I am not ordinary. Whatsoever I put my hand to do is blessed. There's always a market for what I create. You are not saying, what if I do it, nobody. No. As long as I do it, there must be a market for it.
That's right.
As long as I write that book, there must be an avenue for it.
Yes,
Lord. Zibondo preko to pre to shinda baba shanda. By the blood of Jesus.
Yes, Lord.
By the blood of Jesus.
Yes, Lord.
By the blood of Jesus.
Yes, Lord.
By the blood of Jesus. By the blood of Jesus. By the blood of Jesus. By the blood of Jesus.
Yes, Lord.
By the blood of Jesus. By the blood of Jesus. Whatsoever I do prospers. That's the word of God. Why? Because heaven and earth must aid you. Heaven and earth must aid you. We've been adopted. We are God's begotten. We are the offspring of God. We are separated from the world.
That's right.
Yeah. We don't go through what the world goes through.
That's right.
Somebody begin to praise the Lord. I said, you are an off. If you are an off, you speak to your situation. I belong to God. Yeah. You are not panicking like the world panics. You are not helpless or hopeless. If you are begotten of God,
yes,
and you're obedient to the word of God, and your life testifies that you are committed to the things of God, guess what God will do for you?
Hallelujah.
God will surely help you.
Yes, he will.
No matter how hard things may look like, God will come true for you.
Hallelujah.
No matter how complex things may seem to be, God will come true for you.
That's right.
No matter how difficult, de brusa mato le prose kondo shaba. No matter how challenging it may look like, God has the power to come true for you.
That's right.
There's somebody right now, you're hearing my voice. Que le prosso ti mashi. That which the enemy has programmed to enslave your glory. The sons of Satan. Satan's children. You know, God has children. Satan has children.
Oh, yes.
Bible says, Jesus says, the wicked ones, wicked men, evil men on this earth. And liars and deceivers. They are satanic sons. They are children, offspring of the devil. There are two families on the earth. You can never be in both of them at the same time. You are adopted to one at a time. So that you are under satanic covenant, Satan's family, or you're under God's family. There's no neutrality. There's somebody hearing my voice this morning. Your business has been going through some attack. This is what the enemy is planning. The enemy has planned to yoke you. So the enemy has formed a system whereby you are working for the enemy. You are a child of God, but there are certain sons of Satan you have yoked yourself with in partnership. Therefore, you are working for the enemy in regard. See, the enemy wants to keep this thing you are in for months to come so the enemy can control you. They've had a meeting. They said there's potential in what you are doing, but they want you to remain there so they'll be going back and forth with you so that they can continuously. It's like an investment. They are now the overall management, but you are a manager, but they are the one managing your resources. Call it off and cut off. Separate yourself.
Amen.
Separate yourself, says the Lord. I'm talking about the offspring of God. And one of the benefits of being an offspring of God is unlimited resources on the earth. I said unlimited resources on the earth. That which you are looking for is in you.
Yes, Lord.
As a child of God, the gold mine is inside of you. The diamond heel is in you.
Hallelujah.
Thank you, Lord. Because we're a peculiar people.
Yes, we are.
What is peculiar about you? Well, you are a child of God. You're born of God. You're not just a Christian, a follower, but you are a child. You are born of God. That makes you peculiar.
Yes.
And because the whole earth belongs to God, there's hidden resources in you that when you begin to bring it out, there are angels assigned to market it for you. There are angels assigned to open the doors for you. There are angels assigned to encourage you. There are angels assigned to aid you. There are angels assigned to call it to prosper. There are angels assigned to call it to be a life-changing impact on society. Father God, I begin to thank you, oh God, that I'm a peculiar person.
Yes, Lord.
I'm not an ordinary person. The peculiarity of your love for me manifests itself today.
Yes, Lord.
The peculiarity of your love for my family, my spouse, my children, my wife, my partners manifests today. The peculiarity you have concerning our destiny in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ. Lepro soto baka liprondoshi. Makando pre kondo lepro zonda bakondoshi. We are peculiar people.
Yes,
we're peculiar people unto you, God.
Yes,
we are peculiar in our communication. We are peculiar in our enterprise.
Yes,
we are peculiar in our passion.
Lepro sakande.
My God, I thank you for your promise, oh God.
Thank you, Lord.
My Lord and my God, that Lord, I am above all nations that are upon the earth. I stand upon that promise.
Yes, Lord.
I am above every nation and race of people on the earth.
Hallelujah.
I say it boldly and confidently. The wicked shall not have dominion over me.
No way.
Every wicked one that seeks to establish himself as Lord over my life, I release the fire of God right now. I said every evil authority on the face of this earth that has assigned itself, that wants to contend with my birthright, I said let the fire of God strike you down. Every principality and powers of darkness hovering upon my destiny, hovering upon my children, hovering upon my resources, that wants to belittle you my inheritance, that wants to belittle you my grace, that wants to belittle you my anointing, I say, cast fire
in
the name of the Lord Jesus.
Christ.
In the name of the Lord. Depo soko labashonte. Makando pre kulabosi. Lepro dosi. Come on, somebody begin to pray with me this morning. Begin to pray, begin to pray, begin to pray. Lepro sonto. We decree and declare. Today.
Jesus Christ.
I step into my inheritance.
Yes, Lord.
I step into my godliness. I step into my birthright. I step into my sources. I step into my promise.
In the name of
I belong to God. I am God's product. I belong to Jesus. I have the mark of God in me.
Yes,
I'm a peculiar person. I'm above all the nations in America.
Yes,
I'm above all the nationalities in America.
In
I don't go through the same thing they go through because greater is he that is in me that, oh my God.
Hallelujah.
I'm born
Hallelujah.
Of God.
Yes, Lord.
The abilities of God in me. Failure is not in my DNA. Oh, la bro, san te kete. Failure is not a part of me. Disgrace is not a part of me.
No
poverty is not a part of me.
The
Though
of
there
Jesus
may be temporary
no
season
way.
Of lack, I command the solutions to come over that
in
lack now.
Jesus,
I command Lord. The resources to come over that lack now. Oh my God. Somebody, you are rising up again from the ashes. You are coming out of that corridor of backwardness. Hear me. You are coming out of that corridor of disappointment. Hear me. You are coming out of that corridor of...
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah. I am a child of God. I refuse to be treated like a child of the world. I refuse to be equal with the child of the world. I refuse to go through the same challenges. I overcome new challenges. I overcome new problems. I overcome new delay. I overcome new setback. I overcome you in the name of Jesus. 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 Le pro soto breku la baba shanda. Mando bre to breku la baba sonte. Le pron do breku la baba bashunda. Manto ble dobri gala baba basunda. Mazo bon dobli da bragi da baba sonte. Kuse kuto kinda kinde. Mazo kondo breku la baba sonto. Le bro kondo breku libra gandi di sunda. Libra gandi brigi di sonto. My God, my God, my God, my God. La baba basunte baba kunda. I am a child of God. I am born of God. My God, above all nations that are upon the earth, I have priority. Hey, la bosomde. I have priorities. Somebody begin to talk to God this morning. Lord, there are priorities in my life. May ye so te pruta bosim. Mando libro son tabondo brinde. Mazo binda brondo brinda boshi. Malabanda brondo bringa dobo bobo. Libondo brondi bambondo bringa dobo boshi. Le prozondo bondo brigala baba shinda. Le pondo brondi brondo bobo boshinda ba. Ne prozondo bondo brendo brida baba. Lo pondo brozida bondo brigado boboshi. Mazo bondo bondo bigendebedi. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Ma ande kusento bira bronti. Thank you, Jesus. Blessed be your name. Blessed be your name. Blessed.